Dr. Grubbs is Assistant Professor of Medicine in the Division of Nephrology at UCSF, where she has maintained a clinical practice and clinical research program for the last 5 years. She received her undergraduate and medical degrees from Duke University after her internal medicine residency at Highland Hospital of Alameda County Medical Center. She completed the General Medicine Clinical Research Fellowship and Nephrology Fellowship at UCSF. Dr. Grubbs is currently conducting exploratory research to pilot a conservative management program for patients with end-stage kidney disease at SFGH. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Grubbs.
So I wanted to start with a story, a patient case of someone that I was involved with. And this is the story of Mrs. Lee. I met her just as I was making that transition from fellow to faculty. So I was so new that I was still reminding myself, oh, I don't need to go out and talk to the attending. I can just talk to the patient I'm attending now. So that new. And of course, I'm sure. So Mrs. Lee, she's 83. Lovely lady, and she comes to the visit in an unfortunately named pre-dialysis clinic. She comes in with her granddaughter. The granddaughter, I suspect, speaks and understands a lot of English, but Mrs. Lee herself, the only English words I heard her say were, "Thank you, doctor." So we have the language barrier to deal with. So her kidney function was estimated a GFR of about 16, but she also had a lot of other medical problems, including coronary artery disease. She had a lot of mini strokes. She had gout that flared occasionally, and she, in the last year, she had been hospitalized for ischemic colitis. So a lot of problems. So I'm seeing her in the clinic, and at the prior visit, my colleague, who just weeks before had been my attending, had moved her along in the process for actually preparing for dialysis. So she was supposed to see the vascular surgeon the following week, but she expressed some concern about that. She was a bit ambivalent about just seeing the surgeon and about dialysis in general. So what I'd like to do is just have you all think about this particular case or a case that you've been involved in that is similar, and think about what is difficult about this situation, like if you were me or in your particular situation, and at the risk of not being able to bring you back in a timely fashion, I would like everyone to turn to their neighbor and just for a minute talk about what would make this particular situation difficult. If you could do that now, just pair up. And if you're a trio is fine. Okay, so I would like to hear from you about what was said in your pairs. What do people come up with? What's difficult about this particular situation? Anybody? All her other medical problems, just making it a difficult thing to deal with. Okay, what else?
Language barrier.
The language barrier?
The fact that you now need to be in an attending role, and mm-hmm. you heard things differently than your prior mentor.
Mm-hmm.
Great. How do you communicate that?
Right. Okay. What else?
The perception, your perception and definition or understanding why they didn't keep this appointment with the vascular surgeon versus why they didn't keep it for Mrs. Lee or her granddaughter.
Okay.
You know, you're interpreting that one way as, you know, beginning the non-compliance problem.
Oh, no, her appointment is the following week. She just worried about
it. Oh, I thought it was supposed to be in the interim.
No. Okay. Anybody else?
It's pre-dialysis.
Yeah, just the name alone, huh, makes it kind of hard to have a different conversation. One last one.
Granddaughter's role.
Mm-hmm. Okay, really good. You all came up with a lot of things that I definitely thought about as well. And here's a list of some of the things that I was thinking about, but it's certainly not exhaustive. So just talking about prognosis and death makes, you know, just this kind of conversation difficult. Our own uncertainty about what we can expect for this patient in front of us and what dialysis will mean for this patient in front of us, as some of the other speakers have alluded to. We have some general knowledge, but we've all seen times when we thought a person wouldn't do well and they actually did do well, or a person that we thought would do well and they didn't. And then dealing with the emotions and all of the patient and family perspectives and the thought about the cultural aspects, how they play into it. And of course the time. This is not something you can do in 5 or 10 minutes. And particularly when there is a language barrier, you have to double how much time it takes. So I want to tell you a bit more about how this particular case went. So at San Francisco General Hospital, I feel very fortunate that we do have very readily available access to interpreters. So I was speaking, I was conducting a visit with an interpreter by the speakerphone, and I brought up that I too felt ambivalent about this patient going forward with dialysis because, as someone else already brought up, she was really sick and she's 83, and you know, there's a lot going on. And I said that I suspected that the granddaughter understood a lot of English because before the interpreter could say what I said, I saw her body language shift like, are you trying to kill my grandmama? You know, it was like that kind of body language. That coupled with the fact that, you know, my colleague who was just my attending had at least 25, 30 years on me in terms of experience, and who was I to change the course of what would happen with this particular lady. So what I did was just back off, and I just left things to go on the path that she was already set on. And about 6 months later, she had had two surgeries, you know, the first surgery to get her fistula in place and the second surgery to bring it closer to the surface, and it was working just fine. A year later, she started dialysis, and a few months after that, she jumped off the roof of her fifth floor, a five-story apartment building. So this case to me certainly demonstrated that we can do better. We have to do better. Even though it's really hard, it's really difficult, we have to do better. And Ms. Lee, for me, certainly made me want to get more involved in this work and thinking about how we can do better. Sorry, I always get a little bit emotional about that, even though when I practice, I'm just fine. It's hard to think about. So what I'd like to do is back us up a bit to think about kind of the situation that we're dealing with. Patients like Mrs. Lee are not uncommon, and this is very different from when it started out, when dialysis first became this thing, and it was a limited resource. I have data here from an article published in the 80s. In 1967, there were very few people who were not young, and everyone was pretty much healthy besides the end-stage kidney disease. So the goal could be to not just about survival, but about rehabilitating people so they could get back to work and take care of their families. But now we have a very different demographic for our dialysis patient population, where over half of our population is over 62, and the prevalence of people who are over the age of 75 has doubled over the last two decades. And people are sick. Most of our patients have a lot of other medical problems in addition to the end-stage kidney disease. So that kind of takes rehabilitation a bit off the table, and if we're being honest with ourselves, the primary goal is just about extending survival. And I would like for us to consider that dialysis is not all bad, but it's not all good either. So this is a paper published by James Shell and Rob Cohen last year that spoke to the potential benefits and burdens of dialysis. So dialysis, of course, can extend life for most people. It can provide some symptom relief in terms of fatigue, improving appetite, and for a lot of people, it can improve their quality of life. And then there's the part about the social aspects. If you're a part of this community where there's other people going through things, that the same thing that you're going through, and if there's supportive staff there, these are all important benefits of dialysis. But this has to be weighed against the potential burdens of it. When a person starts dialysis, we just automatically enroll them in a whole set of things, particularly with procedures for access. It has to be monitored, there's procedures. If it's about to clot, they need a fistulogram. All these things come with just starting dialysis. And as well as the time spent doing dialysis, not just the actual 3-4 hours that they're sitting in that chair, but are doing peritoneal dialysis at home. But if they are going to a center, the time it takes to travel to and from dialysis. And then people are pretty much automatically set up for increased hospitalizations, they have setbacks, and then there are the symptoms that are related to dialysis itself. Dialysis can make people feel tired, people have cramping, people have pain. So there's a lot of things that go along with dialysis. So it becomes this kind of balance for when we're looking at the patient in front of us. Do the burdens exceed the benefits, or do the benefits exceed the burden? And as we think about this, we really have to consider what we're dealing with. So this is a study that Manju published a couple years ago, and it really demonstrates how different, particularly older people, can be. I'm sure we've all met very spry 80-year-old people, and we've met very sickly 65-year-old people. So those are very different. And what is shown in this figure is the quartile of life expectancy by age group. And what I want to point out is that for my patient, Mrs. Lee, so she would fall in this group, I would probably have considered her in the 50th percentile. She was, you know, she walked in without a cane or a walker. She seemed to have her faculties pretty much intact. So you can imagine, for me, I would imagine that when she started dialysis, she probably would have lived on average about a year. But a frail person would live much less longer. So, and another study by Manju, looking at 3,700 nursing home patients. And what this shows is a percent of residents and what happened to them in terms of their functional status within different months after starting dialysis. So 3, 6, 9, 12 months. The darker bar is if they died, the lightest bar if their functional status declined. And this middle color, if they actually improved, so if they actually got better with our treatment. So if you look at here, just at 3 months, less than half the people were better off than when they started. So more than half were either dead or had less functional ability than before they started dialysis. So these are things that we really need to keep in mind. And I think we should understand this is the case because dialysis is not this miracle thing that makes everything better. It can correct the uremia that goes along with end-stage kidney disease, but the trajectory of end-stage kidney disease still continues. So what this figure shows is time by functional ability by different disease states. And what I want to point out here is here end-stage kidney disease is compared to similar conditions like heart failure and COPD. And as you see, there's dips where people have setbacks, maybe an acute illness, they land in the hospital, that kind of thing. But it's important to see that they never quite get back to the baseline where they were. The trajectory still continues. So this is end-stage kidney disease on dialysis. This red line is from a study where people had end-stage kidney disease but did not start dialysis. And, you know, you can point out that there's a difference in times in terms of where death was. The people who did not start dialysis died here, but the people who weren't on dialysis died here in this schematic. But we need to think about, is prolonging survival the only thing or even the most important thing to think about as we're helping our patients make decisions? And I think, as was pointed out earlier, there's several studies that give us some evidence that dialysis or not starting dialysis, the ability to prolong survival varies depending upon how sick a person is. So this is a study from the UK looking at a little over 800 people, and the figure on the left here shows people who have low comorbidity, so otherwise fairly healthy. And of course, starting dialysis does prolong survival significantly. But for people who were very sick, as shown in the figure on the right, there's really not that much difference, well, no statistical difference in how long people survive. And what I want to show you in this slide is from another study published by Carson and colleagues that really, I think, demonstrates where that time goes. So as you can see here, this is survival in months along the x-axis, and it's separated by people who had supportive care, and people who supportive care without dialysis, and people who started dialysis. And this is from a single center, again in the UK. But as you can see, the people who did start dialysis had a considerably longer survival than the folks who did not, but a big bulk of that time was spent having dialysis, and a much greater chunk of that time was spent in the hospital compared to the folks who had supportive care without dialysis. So again, this is all to drive home the point that survival is not the only thing that we should be thinking about. And this is the third time you're seeing the study, so that just makes it drives home the point of how important this is. So this is the study showing that people you know, on dialysis compared to people with cancer or heart failure spent more time in the hospital in general and in the ICU particularly, and were more likely had much more death in the hospital. And as has been pointed out, is dialysis patients had much less hospice care. And as others have said, this is inconsistent with what people say they want. There's been a couple of studies, one in the US that showed, this was by Hines, published in 2001, that showed that only 18% of the people that she surveyed said that they would want to prolong their life even if they're suffering. And as was presented earlier, a paper published by Sarah Davison in 2010, only 18% said that they would want to prolong their life with dialysis, and only 27% said that they want to die in the hospital. So most people said they wanted to die outside of the hospital. And with this data, I would like to make the point, though, even the way I see it is, even though a lot of people say they don't want to die in the hospital, a lot of people make that decision when they're well. And then they get sick, and they're surprised, and they don't know what to do, and then they want to go to the hospital. So I think some of that is on us for not fully explaining and supporting people as they make this transition through this really difficult disease. So switching a little bit on to when should we consider withholding dialysis, just not starting dialysis. And as I've kind of touched on, as have other speakers, there's been several studies that have shown that if you have two or more of these predictors, that equates with a very poor prognosis for starting dialysis. So in particular, age over 75, functional ability, and the way the best way I've heard of the kind of eyeball interpreting this is for people who spend more than half their time in a chair or a bed have very low functional ability. People who have poor nutritional status, and the easy marker for this is albumin. And then, of course, people who have several other problems in addition to the end-stage kidney disease. And most notably, dementia or peripheral vascular disease have been particularly associated with a poor prognosis. So I want to bring your attention to this resource that Kate brought up earlier from Advanced Care Planning. This is a video that's 11 and a half minutes long. I like it, it's very nice, and it presents dialysis as an option, not the only thing that can be done. And it also goes into a lot of really good information about non-dialytic care as an option and not as a death sentence. And it gives the information as well that people have variable survival. That's for some people it is days, but for some people it's months. And at the end of the video, it encourages the patient to talk to their provider. So, and I think this is a great thing, because when we talk about this shared decision making, the longer name is shared informed decision making. So we as a provider certainly have to be involved in that. I will say though that this is only in English, and I know that there's lots of efforts to get this translated to other languages. And it's specifically for people over the age of 75. But I certainly would like to see in the future, this group or others, produce something that is more about a biological health rather than just chronological health, because I feel like we get a bit into ageism and just looking at older people in my setting, and I'm sure in lots of yours, we see lots of 50-year-olds who we should stop doing things to. But we don't have that conversation because, oh, they're so young, and we should keep going. And I don't think that's wise. But, so, what do we do when the patients come back to us and there's time to start thinking about a decision? And here, you have to forgive me, this is a little bit physician-centric, but thinking about the nephrologist as the expert and the patient as the expert as well. And what we both bring to the table, and both are equally, at least equally important. So the nephrologist as the expert we bring our knowledge of procedure. What does a dialysis actually entail? What are the benefits of it? What are the burdens of it? And what can the patient expect in terms of prognosis with whatever option we're presenting to them? But the patient is an expert as well. They know what quality of life means to them. They know what's important to them. And they have their own set of goals as well as concerns. So we need to bring these two experts together, and then at the end of it, have a recommendation. And I can't remember, maybe it was Sarah that brought up this, that, you know, we can't expect patients to do this by themselves, or families do this by themselves. That's not informed decision making, that's just based upon what they know for themselves. So we as providers, I think is part of what we signed up for when we went into this field. We need to engage and give people our expertise. So in the same paper from Michelle and Cohen, they present a very nice framework for how do we do this? How do we go about having these conversations about dialysis decision making? And this is really adapted from the oncology literature. Some of you may be familiar with the framework SPIKES. And this is SPIRES. And the K is changed to R. And what I think is particularly important to remind us that it's important that we make a recommendation. But just quickly going through it, before we get to the recommendation, of course, it's important to have the setup. The S is for setup. That means we have to have done our homework. We need to know what's going on with the patient, what their prognosis is from the various standpoints, and that might mean talking with other specialists, the primary care doc, and of course, having some time to have this conversation and having the people that are involved in the decision making in the room. And then the P is for perceptions, and this is where we ask the patient and the family or whomever is in the room, what do they understand about their disease and what do they understand about what the options are? And again, this is for us to kind of know where we're starting from. And we don't always have to start at zero. And I think a way to look at it is, this is a big time saver. If we ask the patient what they understand, then we don't have to go through explaining everything as if this is a person that's completely naive. So I think it's important for us to remember this. And then the I for invitation, asking the patient if they do want to hear what we think, if that's something that they're ready to receive. And of course, the recommendation. And then this is an emotional thing, so empathizing with the feelings that inevitably come up with these types of conversations, and just acknowledging that it's not an easy situation. And then finally, summarizing and strategizing. So this is all nice, it's another acronym, but what do you actually say? So I think this is very nice in terms of what to actually say when we're making a recommendation. And here's two examples. So, patients who have been in your situation sometimes experience more of the side effects of dialysis than the benefits. So when a patient has other medical conditions besides the kidney disease, dialysis may not actually make their life longer. Another way to approach it is to say, based on your goals, I would recommend that we start dialysis with the hope that you are able to spend more time with your grandchildren, for example. I also want to talk about the situation if dialysis does not achieve these particular goals, or if it becomes too burdensome. And I particularly like this last line because it makes it very clear that this is an open conversation. This is not the only time that we're going to talk about this. Nothing is etched in stone. We can keep coming back to it. And particularly in the situation where people feel like this is what they have to do. So it sets up that expectation that this is a continual thing that we're going to come to. And if we're not meeting the goals that we said, that you said you wanted, then we can always talk about what can we do differently. So the then what? So a patient, you and the patient and the family have come together and made this decision to go forward with a supportive care without dialysis approach. Then what do we do? I think the most important thing is to assure comfort that we can focus on the things that we're going to do rather than, just focusing on we're not going to do dialysis. But rather, this is what we're going to do. We're going to have, if you develop these particular symptoms, these are the medications that are available for this. And particularly about the non-abandonment. I remember also early on in my transition to faculty, just interacting with fellows who would make comments like, they don't want to start dialysis, so they don't need to come back to this clinic. And thinking, we have more to offer than dialysis. And so I personally have felt like it's important for us to stay engaged with patients to make sure that they're not feeling like, we're just dropping them because they're not doing what we say they should do or whatever. And then also important to address the timing, kind of what can they expect with their particular level of kidney function. And I think we have to really get away from being uncomfortable about the uncertainty around things. And I know, since I am a nephrologist, I feel like it's okay for me to talk about nephrologists. But we tend to be very nerdy, and we like our detail, and we want things to be precise. That's why we get into things like acid base and arterial blood gases and all this kind of thing. And it's hard to look at the individual and be, it's impossible to look at the person and say, so you're going to live 10 months, 4 days, 17 hours, and 22 minutes. And it's like, that's not the only thing. It's like, if we can't say that, we feel like, I don't want to say anything. But there is an entire range. And the range, I think, goes from the person who is a complete novice, who has no medical training, no medical information. But there is a spectrum, and again, we as an expert, we do have some knowledge. We don't know precisely, but we have an experience that is incumbent upon us to share with patients and their families about what they can potentially expect in terms of just saying things like, other people in your situation, and we can use the data that we have, particularly like the prognostic information that I showed you from Manju's work, as well as there's several diagnostic tools that spit out numbers for us, but we can say in general, people like you survive about this amount of time. For you, it may be a little shorter, it may be longer, but this is in general. And then this leads us into that we should explain to people what they can expect in terms of what passing of end-stage kidney disease without dialysis actually looks like. And then, of course, consulting other people. And this, I know, is highly variable, even in my own setting. We are working towards having an outpatient palliative care presence, but we don't currently have one. So that makes it difficult. So how do you actually do this? And what I try to do is when I do reach out to my inpatient palliative care colleagues and ask their advice on how I can approach this particular patient in front of me in an outpatient setting, or involve the primary care doc, and involve our hospice colleagues. Maybe they can't get involved formally, but they can advise us. And particularly the primary care doctors, I think, have a lot of access to resources that can maybe simulate an outpatient palliative care presence through like visiting nurses and that kind of thing. So I do acknowledge that sometimes we have to cobble things together, but I think we have to try. It's too important not to do everything that we can. So switching gears to when to consider withdrawing dialysis. So people who are already on dialysis, I think there are three particular example situations that have already been touched on this morning. So for the patient who's already on dialysis, who develops a severe illness that changes their life expectancy, maybe they just got diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, for example, that's a big change. And so if that would be an important time to start thinking about what we're going to do going forward. And we see this a lot. Patients who are in the hospital, they have acute kidney injury, AKI, and they're starting on dialysis. But maybe the prognosis for them is not really clear, nor are the goals of care. Another situation is a patient who just has progressive decline, as I showed you in the figure earlier. That is just what happens. End-stage kidney disease is not a nice disease, and it just gets worse over time. So as we see people who have progressive cognitive decline or functional decline, there's more and more hospitalizations, they're just getting sicker and sicker, we need to think about at least having conversations about withdrawing dialysis. So how do you do this? So again, I think it's important that we just raise the issue. To just ignore it is, I think, setting up our patients and their families for a lot more suffering than they would have to if we stepped up into these definitely difficult but necessary conversations. And if the patient actually brings it up, we need to support that. So that they don't feel like they've just said this taboo thing, and they can feel supported, and not that they're giving up, that kind of thing. And the rest are the same as we would approach patients who opt to never start dialysis in the first place. Again, we need to assure their comfort. Here, things are of course much more kind of acute because these are patients who are already dialysis dependent. So. In terms of the non-abandonment and addressing timing, these become even more important. That is probably not a month's type of thing that people who have not started dialysis, but more the median time of like 7 to 10 days is when people might expect to pass. Some may be just a couple days, some may be a couple weeks. And so just giving people that sense of what they can expect and just acknowledging that we can't really be more precise, and that because that's the best we can do. And then again, explaining to people what they can expect, that they might expect for the patient and for the family as well, that the patient might become more confused or might have changes in their breathing patterns. But again, focusing on what we can do instead of the focusing on the fact that we're taking this thing away. And of course, consulting our palliative care hospice colleagues to get involved and help with this transition and try to assure that we're going to keep the patient comfortable and minimize suffering as much as possible. And then the final thing I'll say is that maybe we should consider, I think we should consider saying goodbye. And I think this is important just from just communicating the sense of how much we care for our patients, how engaged we've been in their care, and then to just give us all a bit of that closure that I think we sometimes look for but miss. And what has been a model for me, and I have tried in my own practice, and know, I will acknowledge it, it's difficult, but to say a statement like, in case I don't see you again, I just want to let you know that it has been my honor to be engaged in your care, or to communicate to them a particular, or a few particular characteristics that you admire. I've really admired your strength, how you persevered, your courage, and leave it at that. And I think for, in my experience, it does give the patient that sense of really being cared for and that their care is going to continue, maybe not exactly with you, but with others who are going to care for them just as much. And so with that, I will say goodbye.